Very good evening to all. I, Anvita Reddy, on behalf of Extramural Lecture Stream of IIT Madras, welcome you to the 16th lecture of the ML series 2016-17. We have with us today Ambassador Nirupama Rao, who will speak on life and diplomacy. Ambassador Nirupama Rao is a 1973 batch Indian Foreign Service officer who served as India's Foreign Secretary from 2009 to 2011, as well as being India's ambassador to the United States and China in her career. In July 2009, she became the second woman to hold the post of India's Foreign Secretary, the head of the Indian Foreign Service. In her career, she served in several capacities, including Minister of Press, Information and Culture at the Indian Embassy in Washington, D.C., Deputy Chief of Mission in Moscow, stints in the MEAS Joint Secretary, East Asia and External Publicity, Ambassador to Peru and China, and High Commissioner to Sri Lanka. Ambassador Nirupama Rao was a fellow at the Weatherhead Center for International Affairs at Harvard University, where she specialized on Asia-Pacific security. In February 2016, she received the Vanita Ratnam Award for the Government of Kerala. She also topped the IFS and civil services examinations. We now request EML core member Arjun Prasannan to welcome the guests with a fruit basket. Thank you, Arjun. I now invite Ambassador Nirupama Rao to deliver her much anticipated talk.
Good evening to all of you. Thank you all for being here this evening. It is a pleasure and a privilege to be here at the IIT Chennai and to be able to address all of you. I'm not sure to what extent you have been exposed to what the Foreign Service is about, although many of you, I'm sure, are looking possibly at a career in the civil services also. But I don't know if the Foreign Service has been marketed well enough for each of you to see the appeal of a life and a career in diplomacy. Because when I was growing up, and your age, when I was in university, all of us who lived in the larger cities, I'm not really saying what it might have been like in small towns or in the rural areas of the country, but those who lived in the bigger cities, who went to the metropolitan universities, were very attracted to a career in the Foreign Service. You had the Indian Administrative Service, of course, and you had the Indian Foreign Service, and very often the Indian Foreign Service used to be the first preference that you indicated when you applied to the UPSC to take the examination. In those days, we didn't have the preliminary level of examination. We just took, you know, three of the general papers and five of the optional papers all together. It was like one adrenaline rush, eight papers together you had to prepare for, and then if you qualified, you were called for the interview. But the Foreign Service was a top attraction, definitely. And why did people want to join the Foreign Service at that stage? You know, at that age, your aspirations are very lofty, but you may not have very concrete explanations about why you want to pursue a particular career. You have either been inspired by a relative or somebody you have read about or a leading personality in your country. It could be any of these. So in my generation of you, of course, you had people like K.P.S. Menon, Ambassador K.P.S. Menon. You had the first Prime Minister of India, Jawaharlal Nehru, who himself was the country's first foreign minister and who in many ways was the architect of independent India's foreign policy. So another, you know, inspirational figure for many in my generation. I remember when I was in college, in the final year of college, in my master's program, the independence of Bangladesh happened. You know, the whole East Pakistan insurrection and how India was able to intervene successfully and help the Mukti Bahini really achieve the independence of Bangladesh from Pakistan. So that again, you know, focused a great deal on the work of our diplomats, because of course the army led the way, the military led the way, the operations were successful, but then diplomacy had to come in and the second stage. Because a few months later, in early 1972, you had the Simla conference, where Prime Minister Bhutto of Pakistan came to Simla, came to India for talks with Indira Gandhi. And that was the genesis of the famous Simla Agreement, which we still quote almost like a mantra when we say that India and Pakistan have to settle their differences bilaterally on the basis of the understandings reached during the Simla Conference of 1972. So the profession of diplomacy is not what very often the public assumes it to be, that it's a very airy fairy, business. You're living in a bird sanctuary, literally. You know, you're cut off from the rest of the world. It's not like that. The example I cited, once the military action was over, diplomacy had to come in order to settle, in order to negotiate, in order to reach a consensus, in order to set a certain blueprint for the future, if there had to be one. We are still, of course, searching for that future in India-Pakistan relations because we still haven't been able to achieve that equilibrium. But there are many other reasons for that, not the Simla conference, definitely. So the role that diplomacy plays is certainly a complicated and complex one. And diplomacy is a profession, just like you have a profession in engineering or a profession in medicine or law, or to be a scientist and researcher, an information communication technology specialist, or robotics. I mean, it may not sound as interesting or as mysterious as robotics may, at least for lay people like us, but certainly diplomacy, because it's so imperfectly understood by the vast majority of the population, then becomes a certain, quite an abstruse subject for most. What do you do in the Foreign Service is what one is often asked. And that may account for the reason why, when many of you apply for the civil services, you apply for something in your career in the IAS or the Income Tax Revenue Service or the Audits and Accounts or the Customs Service or even also the police, because these are very much in the here and now of what you see and feel in daily life. Whereas diplomacy is not, you only perhaps see a foreign dignitary come to India with a delegation, there are some talks, what are they doing? That's the question they always ask, people ask. What do you do if, as a diplomat, what is your day like? I've often been asked that question. It's a day like anybody else who works. I mean, you have to slog it out, you have to meet deadlines, you have to be able to write well, you have to be able to speak well, and you have to be the master of your brief, because you have to digest a whole lot of information. As Pico Iyer, whom many of you may have heard of, often says, this is an age of information obesity, data obesity, and diplomats also have to, deal with that mountain of data that you have to be able to sift through, to make sense of, to analyze, because you have to brief your superiors, you have to be able to speak coherently, speak with a sense of confidence, speak with a sense of conviction. You have to be good advocates for the country. You're really advocating the national cause. So just as you do in other services, in this particular service, the Foreign Service, I think there's a lot of intellectual input that is required. You have to be well read in the history of the country. You should know the constitution of the country. You should know the geography of the country, because what is geopolitics about? You hear about geopolitics in foreign policy. It's the confluence of geography and politics, geopolitics, just as the confluence of geography and economics makes geoeconomics. So, or the confluence of geography and strategy becomes geostrategy. So you have to understand the lay of the land, the terrain of the land, its borders, its connections, its connectivity. Diplomacy is about building connections. It's about negotiation. It's an alternative to war. Who wants conflict? I mean, we are all, of course, in a sense, there is a sudden rush, a blood rush, when you think of, we will wreak our revenge, we will conduct our surgical strikes, we will make sure that the other side is taught a lesson. But after that, what? You cannot have a 1,000-year war. I mean, that is going to bleed the country, that is going to bankrupt us, that is going to put paid to our plans of development, all the lofty dreams, very legitimate dreams that we have for the country. We cannot afford, obviously, a protracted conflict with anybody for that reason. So that is again where diplomacy comes in. Diplomacy explores the alternatives to conflict, and it teaches you the art of negotiation and even the art of compromise. Compromise is not a dirty word, because if you look at how even village disputes are settled, there is always a certain amount of give and take involved. And I think if you go into it saying it's my way or the highway, then diplomacy does not succeed. So we diplomats are there to really bring everything down to earth, to be able to take a measure of the environment around us, to understand what the pros and cons available to us are, to size up our opponents properly. Just as you have to size up opponents in the field of war, you have to also size up opponents in the field of negotiation, in the field of statecraft, ultimately in the field of diplomacy. So you don't shoot the messenger. The diplomat is usually the messenger. Very often, the messenger gets shot with the message, because if something doesn't succeed, you blame the diplomat. But there are lots of other reasons why things may not succeed. There may be political reasons. There may be, the intransigence of the other side. The fact that there are leaks. We always have, in our system, because we have a very vibrant, very active media. So leaks are often a phenomenon that plague diplomacy also. Take the instance of our relations with Pakistan. Whenever we have a negotiation or a meeting with Pakistan, you find who is intervening all the time? Media, right? Because you'll find that television has some breaking news, or there is some fake news that is put out. And today, fake news, it's all about fake news. You must have heard the term with the Trump campaign. So fake news, alternative facts, as somebody calls it, alternative facts. So all of these have to be contended with in today's day and age. Very different from 40 years ago, when I joined the Foreign Service. We didn't have 24/7 television. We had Doordarshan, when a very staid 9 o'clock news program, perhaps some current affairs discussion, but nothing like, the talk shows and talking heads and breaking news, and we didn't have social media, we didn't have Twitter, we didn't have Facebook, we didn't have Instagram, we didn't have Spotify, we didn't have, all the platforms that people use today. We didn't have Facebook live chats, for instance, which today, provide so much of a blast, as it were, of information to the person who is consuming the news. So diplomacy has to be much more nimble, much more agile today than it ever was before. We don't have the luxury of waiting till the next news briefing, as we did in my time when I joined the Foreign Service, in the 70s. News briefings at the Ministry of External Affairs were once a week. Once a week, the media, the foreign affairs, that is, there is usually a pool. It's called a Ministry of Defense pool, MEA, Ministry of External Affairs pool, MHA, Ministry of Home Affairs pool. These are the pool of journalists who will come to the briefing, who write on that particular area, foreign affairs or home affairs or security or agriculture or commerce, whatever. So the MEA pool would come to the ministry once a week for a briefing. And whatever was handed out to them would be written about. Or they would drop in, perhaps they would go into the office of the Joint Secretary and ask for an exclusive briefing on something, off the record, as it was called, and perhaps write about it without attributing the source from which they received it. But today it's very, very different. You have to be able to go out there immediately, tweet in 140 characters, about what your response or what your take on a particular problem or a situation is. So you can understand what, how the nature of the business has changed. even though the service, the way we are recruited, the way the exam is written, has not really changed in the last 40 years. But the kind of challenges that you face are completely different, and particularly in communication, because it is like almost 70% of your business now is communication. How you influence opinions, how you're able to mold people's views, and how you're able to detract from the body of fake news or false information that is put out there. And this false news and fake news is not just put out by your enemies. It is put out by all kinds of vested interests. So the kind of antennae that you need and the kind of faculties that you have to develop are so much more complex than they were 40 years ago. And I've seen that evolve over the time I've been in this field, in this business. Because when I became spokesperson of the foreign ministry, the first woman spokesperson of the foreign ministry in 2001, 24/7 television had already come to India by then. And I had to introduce, it had never been done before, the whole system of live briefings. Earlier briefings were always off camera. The spokesman or the spokesperson would invite the pool into the room and then brief them. But suddenly, with 24/7 television, we didn't have the luxury of being able to do that. We had to go in front of the cameras and face the questions directly in real time, live from the pool, from the journalists concerned. And they could pop any question at you. They could ask you a question about the most sensitive of matters, and you would have to be prepared with an answer. So that's where I talked about nimbleness and agility, and that presence of mind that you need to be able to divulge just the right amount of information without giving away any state secrets, but at the same time being able to persuade and to convince your listeners that you are advocating on behalf of the country, that you are sincere, that you are believable, that you have conviction, and that you are a good advocate, that you can be trusted. So the question of trust also comes in where communication is concerned. If you were just to be seen as, somebody who's talking their head off and really not meaning what they say, people don't believe you, and what happens then? They look to other sources, right? They look to other sources for information, and that completely defeats the purpose of what government is all about, what you are putting across in terms of governance, in terms of management of crisis situations. And that's where speed comes in. We've had Mumbai, we had 2611, we had Pathankot. All these have taught us lessons about how quickness, alacrity is also very, very important. Every system needs to have a crisis management plan. You have to be able to have game played this whole thing backwards in order to anticipate the twists and turns in the river, as it were, the rapids that may come your way, the whirlpools that lie ahead. You have to be able to plan. So it's just to come back to my essential point, diplomacy is certainly not like being in a bird sanctuary. It's not about chandeliered rooms and exotic wine and champagne being served. It's not that. There's something, as a Kenyan diplomat said, there is something called gum boot diplomacy. You know what gum boots are? Gum boots are what you wear in slush and rain and swampy terrain. So we many times have to wear gum boots and tread through the slush and through the dirt. I'm talking not literally, but figuratively. You have to be able to practice gum boot diplomacy, not you've all heard of gunboat diplomacy, which was being practiced in the 19th century. You sent in a flotilla of gunboats, you threatened people, and they all fell into line after that. But today it's very different. I think diplomats have to be prepared to go out into the trenches, being able to talk to common people. And from my own life, I can tell you that when I served in Sri Lanka in the early 80s, my work, believe it or not, was with tea estate laborers. It was not with, presidents and prime ministers. It was the Tamil estate laborers who had gone from India to work in the plantations of Sri Lanka in from the 19th century, like indentured labor, went to Mauritius, went to the Caribbean, went to Fiji. Like that, the British took them to Sri Lanka also to grow the tea in Sri Lanka. The tea industry of Sri Lanka was built on the backbone of these laborers who went from India. And they were denied citizenship by the Sri Lankan government after Sri Lanka's independence. They wanted all these people to be shunted back because there was this whole thing about anti-Tamil feeling in Ceylon, later Sri Lanka. And these people bore the brunt of it. They had no papers, they had no documents, they had no identity. And since they were of Indian origin, we felt a special obligation to be at their side. So my work was essentially, I would go out to the tea estates, to the plantations. We would work to help them in their education matters, in the case of, for the women, their health issues. We would try and see how we could assist with hospitals and doctors. And most importantly, I was in charge of also providing some documentation to them because we had agreed, the Indian government had agreed to take back a few of these people, a certain proportion. And the agreement was Sri Lanka would give citizenship to the rest and we would take back a certain proportion to India. But this is a, you can understand when you dislodge human beings who have been in one country for three, four generations, they don't know anything about India, but they're being shunted back, they're put on a boat, sent back. So there's a question of what? Rehabilitation in Tamil Nadu. They came back to Tamil Nadu. They had to be rehabilitated. What kind of jobs would you provide? What kind of schools would you provide to their kids? So these were all issues that were within my purview, very different from a classic concept of what a diplomat will be doing. So just to tell you that, in your job, if you were in the Foreign Service, if you were to take up a job in the Foreign Service, you could be dealing with, as I said, repatriation of Indians. You could be dealing with migrant issues. Migration has become such an important issue, as you know, in Europe with all the Syrian refugees that have crowded into Germany and Sweden and all the attendant problems that have arisen because of that. All that comes within the purview of foreign ministries also, because why are these people moving? How do they move across borders? What are the arrangements you need to make? So the first point of contact will always be the foreign ministry. It will not be, resettlement office in a capital. It will have to go. So a diplomat today has to be so completely ambidextrous. It's like you being able to work from the right side of the brain as well as the left side, right hand as well as left hand. All your faculties have to be, in a sense, honed to understand that you will be dealing with crises like refugees, migration, your citizens being stranded somewhere. You saw the terrible news of two Indians being shot dead in Texas, in Kansas, yesterday. What is the first, point of contact when that happens? It is the Indian consulate, Indian embassy. They are the people who Delhi will phone and say, what have you done? Because the media naturally would be asking questions also about it, and you need to help because the question of how their families can be assisted, how the bodies have to be taken back. All that will come within the purview of what a diplomat has to do. And on the other hand, there are very sort of almost 36,000 feet high issues like nuclear non-proliferation, disarmament, climate change. These are all within the purview of diplomacy also. So you will understand as you go through your career that every 2 or 3 years you will be dealing with a subject that at the first point is new to you, but at the end of those 3 years, you've developed a certain understanding, a certain awareness, a certain exposure to these subjects, and in some cases, you develop a real deep, profound, interest in some of these subjects, like I did with China. I started dealing with China as a young officer. I happened to continue to deal with it for 8 years. So I started with very little knowledge of the country. But at the end of these 8 years, I had become reasonably good expert on the boundary issues concerning India and China, the issue of Tibet, the issue of Himalayan problems, you know, the issue of the tribes that live in the Himalayas, the issue of roads, of connectivity, of troop concentrations, of intrusions that exist because there are problems of divergence between the two countries about where a line should run, one side claiming something on the other side. So all these things one was able to study. I went to Tibet twice in that period, including to Kailash Mansarovar. And you understand so much about the country in the process. It's not just foreign, you know, something completely external that you are dealing with, because when you deal with the neighborhood particularly, and India has seven neighbors, as you know, with, if you look at SAARC, the South Asian Association of Regional Cooperation, there are eight countries including India. So India has seven South Asian brothers and sisters, really. Even Pakistan, unfortunately, we have a very bad relationship with Pakistan, but it's not going to go away just because we have that bad relationship. We will have to deal with it in whatever way we can. So all this neighborhood policy, regional cooperation, connectivity, transportation, trade, people-to-people movements, all that comes within the scope of what a diplomat does today. So I often wish that we could think of diplomacy as a profession, the same way as we think, as I said at the beginning, as a career in medicine or a career in engineering or a career in law, because you have to prepare yourself to be a diplomat just as you have to prepare yourself to be a professional in other areas. I think it's very important for us to have a very professional approach to what diplomacy is about. So when you apply for the Foreign Service, do understand that there is so much in that career that can make you grow as a person. I can tell you that from my own experience. I am married to an IAS officer, and so I have seen, I know that, what shall I say, line of work pretty well, because I saw my husband's postings and the kind of work that he does. And I in my own experience, the kind of things I did, there was nothing in what I did that is in any way less than what was being done in terms of the responsibility, in terms of the weight of the issues, in terms of the impact that decisions taken in this field would have on the future of the country. All that, I think, is absolutely at par with what the IAS does. It's just that you assume that when you're in the field in the IAS and you exert a lot of, you are given, there's a certain status, there's a certain privilege that you attach to the role of a district magistrate or a collector, or a divisional, the head of the division, commissioner of the division, or the secretary to government in the secretariat. But let me tell you, it's just that people don't, as I said, the Foreign Service has not been marketed well enough. I often say, you know, you have had TV serials like Udaan, which talk about, I don't know if you may be too young, but 20 years ago there was a serial like that. It talked about a woman police officer. And it inspired a lot of young girls to join the police service. We don't have a film like that about the Foreign Service, but you know, there are people who live lives very dangerously also in the IFS. Look at our colleagues in Afghanistan. Look at our brothers and sisters who work in Afghanistan. You've heard of one of our diplomats, young diplomats, was literally blown up in a suicide bomb attack. You've had attacks on the embassy. Because you know what a battlefield Afghanistan is, and you know what terrorist groups supported by Pakistan are doing there, and our diplomats have borne the brunt of it. So you know, you live on the razor's edge also in places like Afghanistan, Iraq, Sudan, Libya, all these places. You know, there conflict may break out tomorrow. When I was in Sri Lanka, for instance, I was there as ambassador. I did two postings there. I was there as ambassador in my second posting, and the civil war was not over. And as an Indian diplomat, I had 24/7 security. I couldn't walk out in the garden without armed guards escorting me. My official car was a bulletproof car, almost like a tank. I couldn't open the door myself. It was, you know, so heavy and difficult to manage. And I had to live like that for two years. There was no escape from it. Wherever I went in Sri Lanka, I had to go with paramilitary commandos accompanying me, whichever place I went to, and in my own garden, as I said, in my own residence. So that is a situation that that you have to sometimes be able to accept. But I can tell you the rewards of that kind of a career also. You get to see the first drafts of history literally being written, because you get to know also, just as you get to know common people, like I mentioned, the estate laborers and the people affected by the tsunami. When the tsunami happened in Sri Lanka, you're doing relief work. You are coordinating the visit of your naval ships with relief. You are flying by helicopter to one place or the other to deliver certain relief materials. You are there to hold the hands of people who have lost everything. So many families, including Indians, were affected, as you know, in that natural disaster. So there's that compassionate aspect also that you have to develop. It's not just being a hard-boiled professional, but you also, your human side has to be very, very, your EQ, as they say today, the emotional quotient, just as you have an IQ, your EQ should also be equally evolved, as it were, when you are dealing with situations like that, because people look for that, and people everywhere are able to size you up for your sincerity, for your sense of conviction, and just the genuineness that you're able to convey. So these are some of the situations. And when I was in the USA, I wanted to mention the other thing also. The whole issue of the diaspora. We have close to 30 million Indians settled abroad, as you know. They've gone over the last 1.5 centuries, but particularly in the last 40 years, to a country like the USA, you've had a huge migration of people, of professionals, of people of, you know, people like you. In the old days, in my generation, students in the IIT, many of them, a large proportion of them, would go to the United States soon after they completed their engineering studies to study there. And you know the success stories of many of them. Their names are legendary. So one of my friends, Professor Anil Gupta, who studied in IIT Kanpur, was telling me, he now teaches at the University of Maryland at College Park, that you know, you would wait as an IIT student for the telegram. And it was called the telegram from home. A telegram from home was not from your parents, but from that university in the US that had accepted your admission. So, you know, they were all waiting for that telegram from home, which confirmed the admission to them and which sort of opened the way for, you know, their future in a very different environment. And so that, my generation, many of the IIT students did go like that. And they are the diaspora. They are the successful people who have made, who have lifted India's name so high in the United States. And each of their success stories, I mean, you've read about, I don't need to recount them. But we have, including them, but lots of others also, we have close to 3.5 million Indian Americans, as they are called today, in the United States. And they've changed the image of India. Just as today, you know, when I joined the Foreign Service in the 70s, and the image of India then and the image of India today is so different. And that image has changed because of the technological, information technology progress that India has made, the impact that we have been able to project in other parts of the world. The whole image of India is so different from what it was in the 70s, and people like you have a lot to do with it. So I think that in professions like diplomacy also, the technology aspect, somebody was mentioning today that they would like to work on science policy, science and technology policy. So you need not just work on science and technology policy in the Department of Science and Technology or in the Niti Aayog, or, you know, one of the departments of government. You can work on such policy even in the field of diplomacy, because that, again, is the first point of contact when you reach out to a foreign government or a foreign department.
for you to have that knowledge. And let me tell you that a vast proportion of those who join the civil services today are people who have done engineering, are people who have done even medicine. In the foreign service, we have a very large proportion of MBBS graduates who have come into the service. And I feel that government should be able to use that kind of skill. Because right now, they're doing the traditional diplomatic work. You know, they do the training, they study foreign policy, they, you know, study the history of relations with different countries. But you can use your skills, because today, diplomacy covers so many areas. It covers health policy, it covers science policy, it covers information and technology policy, it concerns energy policy. Energy is a big area for bilateral cooperation and also for multilateral, you know, outreach across the world. If you look at the Paris Climate Conference. Now, if you have expertise in the Foreign Service on such issues, it helps the country immeasurably. So if science and graduates, people with scientific backgrounds, are entering the civil services, my plea to the government is to use these people in a way that deploys their expertise for policy making. Not that after 5 years they just, you know, do everything that is conventional, that is what is, which is easy, I mean, law and order or development, you know, projects or something in the IAS, in the IFS, you know, political relations, trade, business, but also be able to use this expertise. I think that's very important. The United States within the State Department is doing that, but I think we need to do. We have, our numbers in the Foreign Service are still very small. We need to obviously increase the numbers, which government is doing. The numbers are going up, the recruitment numbers are going up. But certainly when compared with other big countries, let's say China, Brazil, United States, the numbers of our Foreign Service are woefully small. We're about 800 officers or so, whereas I think even the Singaporeans have a little more than us, the Chinese much more, even the Brazilians, and the United States, of course, has like a deluge of people working for them. I suppose their resources are so much more. So we are in that sense, I suppose, as our resource position goes up, we will obviously be able to recruit more, because every job, you know, has a certain resource commitment that you have to make. Every place needs that. But it will happen. But in the meantime, I think if we are to create a body of professionals who are well-trained, aware of the world around them, well-read, articulate, quick to adopt technology, understand challenges, and be willing to learn from best practices everywhere, I think, you know, we will be in a much better position than ever before. And I think we have the talent within the country, definitely, to do that. And it's just a question of, you know, that enlightenment, that moment of enlightenment when everything comes together and we're able to look to the future with even more confidence to face the challenges ahead. I think I'll stop here because I'm sure you have questions. It'll be perhaps more productive and more fruitful to do that. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for the fascinating talk. We open the session to questions. A mic will be passed around.
Hey, ma'am, for your talk. I had questions in three areas.
Could you identify yourself also so I know?
Sorry, my name is Lakshmi. I'm not a student here. I'm a resident of the campus. Basically, there are three areas where I have questions. One is, since we are a technology institution, it would be really nice to understand how diplomats are supported from technology. Do you have ways by which you mine social media? Is there a way you're up to date with what's happening and things like that? That's one. Secondly, I think we are now, as Indians, at a state where we are across the world, and is it not time to have reciprocal visa arrangements? Do we have that? And why is it that our citizens are still often treated second rate when we travel? So that's second. And the third is, as a country, we are in an area where we are the biggest in the vicinity, in the location where we are we considering our leadership in the local area and looking at building the neighborhood into a strong economic power force to deal with better negotiation with the rest of the world, you know, for example, with the United States?
To the last question first, as far as the neighborhood is concerned, you all know the story of SAARC, the South Asian Association of Regional Cooperation. We've had, because of our problems with Pakistan and Pakistan's own reluctance to take forward ideas and new proposals and projects that would strengthen the kind of connectivity you're talking of, the regional cooperation, and to create that brand, that South Asian brand, as it were, which will enable you to negotiate on behalf of the region, like ASEAN does, for instance, with the rest of the world. So that has been an obstacle because of the India-Pakistan relationship. But what India now is doing is to follow the path of sub-regional cooperation, like, for instance, with Bangladesh, with Myanmar, create these arcs of cooperation where we are able to surmount all those difficulties that we had previously when you're talking of a bigger arc of cooperation involving a country like Pakistan. So going to sub-regional cooperation. Then you have the Act East policy with Southeast Asia, with ASEAN, that India, you know, used to talk of a look east policy before, and now it's called the Act East. You're acting east. You're trying to promote trade. You're trying to promote better transportation linkages through Northeast India. Because Northeast India, if you look at the states of Northeast India, the ethnic makeup, the old connections through geography, through history, it's all eastward, more than, you know, westward with the rest of the country. So I always say Southeast Asia begins in Northeast India. And so that kind of connections and connectivity, the ports that we are building on the eastern seaboard of India. Now, India's coastline is over 7,000 kilometers long, and we are naturally endowed with the capacity to be a maritime power of global significance, and which we have not really capitalized on. So the question is now to develop those ports. Somebody was telling me about this port just north of Madras, which used to be Krishnadevaraya's port. I think it's Krishnapatnam, I think it's called. It's supposed to be one of the best natural harbors anywhere in the world. And what happens with the continental shelf on the eastern seaboard of India is that, you know, there's a sudden dip, as you know, off the coast. The depth of the sea becomes suddenly quite big. So that helps, you know, that enables big ships to come into our harbors. And that is what we need to really develop. And also to look at ports like Trincomalee in Sri Lanka, for instance, which is very, very big and very strategically important. So when you talk of development, you can couple the strategic interest with commerce, with trade, with the people-to-people contact, because it was through the Bay of Bengal that many of our linkages with Southeast Asia developed, right from the time of the Cholas and the Pallavas, literally. And then through the 19th century, you know all the story of the Chettiars and how they went into Southeast Asia and made their fortunes. And, you know, so many historical connections that you can think of, which need to be leveraged and need to be conceived of in a 21st century framework today, through port development, through ship building. All those industries we need, when you talk of Make in India, these are the areas of focus that we need to do, in addition to all the frontier technologies and new manufacturing technologies that we need. The second question you asked was, what was the second question? Sorry? Can you hear now? Yeah. What was the second question? Yeah. Well, certain countries, we do have reciprocal arrangements, not with many, but certainly the numbers are growing. Numbers are growing where we have reciprocal arrangements. I think that visa policy, I think it's very difficult for us to assume that it's the other country's obligation to allow India. And it's not our government's a responsibility, what shall I say, it is not within the remit of the government, the Indian government in this case, to ensure that there is, that visa requirements are dropped as far as other countries are concerned. These are reciprocal always. The Indian government should be willing also to give those reciprocal arrangements to those nationals of that, those countries that require to come here. Now, in the case of our neighbors, for instance, it'd be very difficult. You can't do that. In the case of China, you can't do that. In the case of developed countries, a developed country should be willing. And I think with progress in India, with the growth of our economic potential, you know, as we become the third largest, the second largest economy in the world in terms of PPP, we are expected to become by 2040, I think we'll become. And China will be the first, and we will overtake the United States by then. So the scenario is bound to change in the next 20 to 25 years. So by the time, you know, you are middle-aged, probably it'll be quite a different scenario. But we have to be patient at the moment. But I certainly think that the scene has changed from 20, 25 years ago. An Indian passport, you know, certainly you have much more respect, recognition, and it's easier, much easier than it used to be before. But now, countries like the US, now you see with the Trump administration coming to power, the whole question of foreigners, the question of immigrants, the question of jobs, the kind of, you know, atmosphere that has been built up around this, that's not very, obviously very conducive to removal of controls. We'll have to see. But we have to, that's where I think working with other countries helps, as to answer your third question. It certainly helps, just as you do for trade or climate change. We need to, but it all depends on, as I said, the host country. It depends very much. And the first question? The technology? How technology can help? Of course, we have social media. I think the whole government has taken to social media. But I know what you mean. Whether people are mining that information, looking at who is following you, you know, what kind of groups you're able to reach out to. That kind of analysis, sorry? No, definitely. That is public diplomacy. That's what public diplomacy is about. Technology will come in there because I suppose it helps you. You know, there is nothing I feel like, you know, managing perceptions through a study of situations on the ground. Like if you are posted in a particular country, you know, no amount of technology can replace the wealth of knowledge that you acquire from just being on the ground, living in that country for 3 years, making friends, acquaintances, understanding the politics and economics of that country. There is no replacement for that. So the Foreign Office will obviously be in close touch with our embassy there, our ambassador, our first secretaries and second secretaries and others who are actually working in the field. And that is where the data mining comes in. Of course, technology is certainly, you know, the algorithms and all that that you're able to study. All that is an additional supplement, I think, to that. And the more you have it, developed countries do a lot of work, I know, in that field. But there's nothing to replace, I think, the human, as they call it, human intelligence that you are able to pick up from the ground. Somebody should, whoever has the mic can. I can hear you, I don't know about the others. Just speak loudly into it, that's fine, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, the impact on the relationship between the neighbors and, you know,
Yeah, I think that's a very good question that you've asked. And I believe that personal relationships in any situation of work, professional situation, are valuable, are useful. You know, even if your counterpart or your, you know, the person you're talking to belongs to the opposite side. Because in any negotiation or any relationship, if you are able to establish a position of credibility, and you know, not just that you are able to speak with all the facts at your command, but being credible, being reasonable, at least appearing to be reasonable, and not you know, in a sense thrusting your personality forward, I think that often detracts from the progress of the negotiation. And in the process, you do build friendships, even if you know you are dealing with the opposite side. And you know that from the policy point of view, you know, take India and Pakistan, for instance. You will always have differences. You may go to Islamabad for a meeting, and there will be points of divergence galore. And everybody will talk about how the talks, you know, in diplomacy, John Kenneth Galbraith, who used to be ambassador of the United States to India in the 60s, used to say that when there is a diplomatic communique saying that the talks were held in a very useful manner, what it means is that they didn't achieve anything. You know, that is diplomaties for saying nothing was achieved. But even if that is the case, and may well be the case with a country like Pakistan or China, on the personal front, you know, just by the fact that you sit long hours together talking about very intractable, difficult, complex issues which are not getting solved, just the human relationships can, you know, be quite normal. The fact that you drink tea together or you break bread together, I think that is a takeaway. And I think it is something one should not, you know, decry or, you know, just dismiss, because I think it is important. And at some stage, it often comes in handy. Today, for instance, let's take leaders of countries, prime ministers of countries. Now, in the old days, they would have to communicate through their secretaries or their ambassadors. But today, you can just send a text message. Now, for instance, my counterpart in Pakistan, the foreign secretary, when I was foreign secretary Salman Bashir, you know, we were on friendly terms with each other, although the relationship was in a complete, you know, some cold storage, you can say. Today it's literally in cold storage. So when we had the evacuation of Indian professionals from Libya, when the Libyan crisis broke out, and we had arranged a special Air India flight for them to come from Tripoli back to Delhi. And the flight had to overfly Pakistan airspace. And when you fly over airspace of another country, you need permission for all these special flights. And since that was arranged at very short notice, the plane had already taken off when the pilot radioed Delhi that we don't have permission to enter Pakistan airspace. And this is an aircraft with 140, 150 people on board. And what do you do? I mean, there's also a public relations issue involved, because if the media comes to know that this happened, then they will be all hell breaks loose. So I just picked up the phone and spoke to Salman Bashir. I said, we have this issue. This plane is approaching your airspace. We need permission from the Pakistan Civil Aviation Organization to give. And it was given in 5 minutes, that permission. So that personal relationship worked. If I was not on that kind of speaking terms with him, we would have gone through the Pakistan High Commission in Delhi, who would have then sent a message to Islamabad Foreign Ministry. Foreign Ministry would have got in touch with the civil aviation people. So it would have taken, by that time, that plane would have been stranded somewhere. So personal relations do matter. Mm-hmm.
evening, ma'am. I am Vibhu. So I have two sets of questions. One considering as an aspirant, and second considering that once I have become, say, IFS. So my question is, do you think that we can have a examination completely different for IFS? How much viable it would be, considering that it's a different set of people who go for?
Skills.
And yeah. And second thing is, particularly when we come to as a diplomat, so how does the diplomacy changes, or how does the entire scenario changes when the government changes in India, or wherever you are posted, there also the government changes? Say the government changes in India, or say considering that the government, wherever you have been posted, it changes. So how does it
happen? So as far as the separate examination for the foreign service goes, many countries have it. And I would, if I were asked by the government, I would certainly advocate a separate exam. Because I think for the foreign service, you know, you need at least about 4 to 5 years of some kind of training, some kind of skill development before you enter. Now today, for instance, you have, as I said, many young people come from, you know, smaller towns, smaller universities. Not like you all, you have been exposed to a lot of, you're exposed to foreign speakers, and your curriculum is very, you know, broad-based. It's not the same when people come from smaller towns and cities. And they come into the foreign service, and it's completely foreign, you know, in many ways. You know the word, what the word foreign means. And it'll take years for them to kind of be, you know, be able to deal with many of these challenges in an efficient way. All of us have native intelligence, we'll be able to do our work. But in order to build that truly professional, as I said, like, you know, you have lawyers and doctors, why not have a school of foreign service also like that? An examination like you have the National Legal Law School examination. Why not have something like that, so that 4 to 5 years they study political science, diplomacy, international affairs, history, so important, geopolitics, strategy, negotiation, all those things. Then if they enter the foreign service after that, you can imagine, even if we have a small number of people, they will be very, very well equipped. And even today, I would say many of our diplomats are among the best in the world. We may be a small group, but if you go anywhere, you talk in the United Nations, you go to the developed capitals, city capital, they all have a good word to say for the professionalism. But, you know, as the country changes, our population grows, many, many more young people from smaller towns and cities enter the job market. They have many aspirations. So let us develop those aspirations properly in a way that they are prepared to face the challenges as India becomes a big power. India is bound to become a big power. It is on the way to becoming, hopefully, a superpower someday. So we have to be equipped for that. We cannot be equipped, in my view, through a general examination. We have 2 to 3 years of training. But if we had a proper, you know, conditioning of these people for 4 to 5 years and then an examination, or even if you just have the examination based on qualifications that people have to write papers in all these subjects, specialist sort of subjects, like, you know, you have if you were to get a MD degree or something. You have to specialize. It is a highly specialized field, in my view. It's not a field of generalists. I certainly don't think so. I think the UPSC probably has to agree. They have to agree. The government may make recommendations, but the UPSC has to agree. But the government needs to come up with a very cogent, detailed, well-structured proposal, which can then be discussed. I think it has to be discussed. It has to become something that enjoys a consensus. Even you'll have to probably go to Parliament, I'm sure, for all this, because there'll have to be some degree of agreement. And there are so many other priorities today in the country, perhaps this has not been pushed to that level. That may be the reason. As far as political change is concerned, I think foreign policy enjoys multi-partisan consensus in this country, and even in other countries I've seen, most foreign policy issues are not a subject of political differences. It's just that, today there's much more public focus on these issues. When somebody gets shot somewhere, or somebody disappears, or there are refugees, or there's some action on the line of control, and what is the Ministry of External Affairs doing about it? So there's much more focus on these issues, so government's role is then questioned. What have you done? Have you done enough? You know, you should have done differently. You should not have had talks. Should we have talks? Should we have not have talks? All that is now, you see, much more in the forefront. But I think by and large, you see, now we have a BJP government in power. Before that, you had the UPA too. I don't think foreign policy has drastically changed. You know, the political party is different. But by and large, the direction of the policy is the same. There may be a few more areas of emphasis. There may be a little more, you know, finessing. There may be perhaps some new initiatives. But the policy direction remains the same. And similarly, in other countries, when leaderships change, policy towards India, I have never seen that. It may happen in Pakistan, definitely. One can't say. Pakistan, because the generals are in charge, whatever party comes to power, they're the ones who call the shots, the ISI and the... There it's different. One can never... One is not sure what tomorrow brings there, except that constant of hostility. Can one hope for something better? That is the $64,000 question. But that's different. But I don't think in many democracies, for instance, if governments change, policy changes. No, not foreign policy. Foreign policy, what is foreign policy about? I mean, I could ask that question to all of you. What is, in your view, can I ask a question now? Can anybody tell me what is foreign policy based on? If you were drawing up the foreign policy of the country, name three sort of basic priorities that you would say are important for a foreign policy. Can anybody answer that question? Put your hands up. It should benefit the people, okay. Common ground with neighbors? Okay. So people, benefit the people, find common ground. Mutual benefit. Yeah, I suppose coexistence, mutual benefit, yeah. Protect, exactly, very important. Project and protect. Protect and project the national interest. What about, you know, being a good adjunct to military power, national security, all that comes in. You're defending the interests of the country. When you say you're defending the interests, you have to take into account the security interests of the country. Plus economic, nobody mentioned economic. You know, what is the country's priority? It is when you say, you know, when Trump says, make America great, or we say, Mera Bharat Mahan, it really means that we want the country to be developed. We want to alleviate poverty. We want to bring in technology. We want to bring in capital. We want to bring in new ideas. All that a foreign policy is supposed to enable. You know, the diplomat may not be doing this, all on their own. They have to get help from other ministries and other departments. But the foreign policy then becomes the kind of enabler. Foreign policy is an enabler for protection, for advancement, for realization of the national interest. Because no country is an island. No country can exist on their own, especially today. What is globalization about? Although there's a huge, counter tide against globalization, that's what you see in Trump's America. You see in Brexit, you see in many other parts of the world, but India hasn't turned against globalization. We have opened our doors to foreign investment, capital, technology, ideas. It's important for our growth. We've benefited from it since 1991. So we are not about to turn our backs on globalization. And foreign policy is needed for that, to project that kind of interest. It's there for conflict prevention. It is there for conflict management. It is there for peacekeeping, the promotion of the avoidance of conflict. but at the same time, the defense of the national interest.
Good evening, ma'am. My name is Sindhu Shekhar. I'm pursuing my PhD here. My question is, India has sought reform of United Nations for a while now. How far does the rising protectionism among developed countries aid in achieving the reform of United Nations?
Protectionism and reform of the United Nations. Protectionism is a question that relates more to trade, because you have, you know, now you see Donald Trump has canceled the Trans-Pacific Partnership, the TPP. And, you know, he has this ongoing wall-building exercise with Mexico. All that is protectionism. When it comes to the United Nations, I think the question of reform, as you rightly said, reform of the United Nations is a pressing need in today's world, because the United Nations essentially expresses the post-World War II world order. When you look at the composition of the permanent five, the P5, the constituents or permanent members of the Security Council, they're essentially the victors of World War II. Although India was a founding member of the United Nations, India was not included, and India was, it is said, offered membership in the 50s, but it was not taken up seriously by Prime Minister Nehru. And my reading is that his reading was possibly that the others were not serious about it either, that it was just one of those perfunctory offers that were being made. But all the same, it was not pursued. You know, we'll have to see what the postmortem is on that. So when you talk of reform of the United Nations, you're basically saying that the structure, the representation of the UN as it exists today, particularly the Security Council, is not reflective of the current global order. And that countries like India, and most people are agreed, deserve to be members of the Security Council, permanent members. But you see, reform of the Security Council very much depends on what the veto-wielding members, the permanent members of the Security Council want. It's like they have an exclusive club, and you don't want to open the doors now to anybody else. But to my mind, continuation of that kind of dispensation really is not good for the health of the United Nations, which is already threatened in many ways. But I'm not saying the UN, for that reason, should be sort of buried, or that we should say, you know, its days are over, because the UN does a lot of good work in development. Look at the UNDP, look at UNESCO, look at UNICEF, in the, you know, what they've been able to do for the cause of children everywhere. Its work in Africa, its work in peacekeeping. So these are all areas, I think, that need to be supported, and which India does a great deal. In climate change, the UN conference on climate change. But it's just where peace and security are concerned, where the Security Council is concerned, that it's crying out for reform. And I'm sure if India had been a member, I think these tragedies that you see in the Middle East today, look at the collapse of Iraq, look at the collapse of Libya, look at what is happening in Syria. You know, we need the voice of people from our part of the world also to weigh in on such deliberations and to see how we can turn the tide and make it a little more reflective of the aspirations of people everywhere. Right now, you know, it's just that small caucus of permanent members, and basically it's the United States, you know, loyally supported by Britain and France, and not so much Russia and China, that have somehow in some ways even flouted the United Nations and gone in to intervene, so-called responsibility to protect. What has it really achieved?
Ma'am, I'm Harshal, and I wanted to ask that after independence, India has largely pursued an independent foreign policy, didn't get pressurized by the rival power blocks. And India is kind of unique in maintaining friendly relations with apparently rival countries like US and Russia. So how do diplomats accomplish that? And secondly, nowadays, when our allies put sanctions on other countries like US on Iran, but we still buy their oil and have some kind of relations with that. So it might anger our allies, or they protest about it. So how do those negotiations are held and our needs are put first. Thank you.
Let me tell you that with Iran, the whole issue of sanctions on the nuclear issue, the nuclear problems, the nuclear development of nuclear arms, or let's say weapon technology by Iran. When that crisis was ongoing, and before you had the nuclear deal between Iran and the United States and the other countries that were in that group, the issue of sanctions, India could not escape either. We could not buy oil from Iran. Because you see, the whole the US control of the world banking system, payments could not be made. You couldn't. So, you know, it's all very well to say we will buy, but, you know, if you bought, your banks could have been sanctioned. Your banks could have been prevented from transacting business in the US and other places, which is very important for our financial health, as it were. So we had to comply with the sanctions. We had to comply with the sanctions, and we had to modify our refineries so that we could buy oil, more oil from Saudi Arabia and other sources, which in fact we did. So in about 2 to 3 years, the entire sort of direction of our imports of such petroleum products changed because of the sanctions. So even a country like India, because we are so interconnected now globally, financially, you know, we cannot follow a closed door policy anymore. And as far as independence of foreign policy is concerned, I think we've done pretty well. I think there is credibility. It's not in the old days where you had American criticism of non-alignment, and they saw us as friends of the Soviet Union. You remember the whole Kissinger-Nixon problems that came up, and which is why we signed the Indo-Soviet Friendship Treaty in 1971, because we were in a situation where we were being threatened by the United States and China. And we had to, in order to see the success of our, you know, the Bangladesh operation, we had to, you know, be able to safeguard our interests. So that independence, and India has a certain brand recognition as being an independent-minded country. Even though our relations with the United States have improved phenomenally over the last 10 years, it's a hugely different relationship today. Or as Donald Trump would say, it's bigly different today, very bigly different. But at the same time, you know, we have a system of leadership level meetings with Russia. Although that relationship has become a little less, what shall I say, prominent. I'm not saying less significant, but less prominent than it used to be in the past. Relations with Japan, relations with Southeast Asia are all very, very important now.
What about China? It props up Pakistan as a front to dislodge our policies, and it doesn't let us lose the sanction on terrorists. What is the way forward regarding
that? Well, I personally think the way forward is not to, make this a public spat between India and China. Because it is a fact that they have taken a certain position on Masood Azhar. They are building the China-Pakistan economic corridor, which runs through Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. They have taken a rather negative position on the entry of India into the nuclear suppliers group. So these are all, you know, difficulties in the relationship. But, you know, we have to tackle these difficulties by sort of railing against China in public. How is it helping us? Because our comparative national strengths at this moment are not equal. The fact is that China has progressed far ahead of us. I think we have to swallow that bitter truth also as a country. And it should spur us to achieve bigger and better things. I think we should understand that for the next 15 years, we have to keep our heads down. We have to focus on faster development, dealing with all the domestic issues that confront us as a nation. And we need to buy time for that. if we are to have conflict with two neighbors, Pakistan and, you know, China, give them left, right and center, how long can we do that? We have to understand, we have to sort of, what shall I say, marshal our resources in the best possible way in order to see how our interests are safeguarded, which means on our borders, for instance, with both these countries, we should have adequate defense capability, adequate roads. For instance, how many roads are we building in our border areas with China? China has built the best highways and roads on their side. They can airlift and bring troops from mainland China to the border with India in a much faster period of time than we can today. So we have a lot of work to do, you know. So I think we have to manage this difference very intelligently. It is a point of difference, no doubt about it. It doesn't make us happy. We can't be happy as a country with what China is doing. But we have to understand that for some time, we will have to focus on internal development, strengthening ourselves, building relations with other countries that can offset China, the damage that China does in our neighborhood. So, you know, provide that kind of pushback. Build our maritime strength. Be a bigger voice in our region. Have better relations with our neighbors, excluding Pakistan. So I think, you know, building that brand is also very important for us. So it's a question of being just balancing it, creating an equilibrium, understanding these differences will not go away because Pakistan will continue to remain an enemy for an indefinite period of time. China, an adversary, may not be an enemy in the sense Pakistan is, but an adversary, definitely. We have to strategize very carefully.
Thank you, ma'am, for that very insightful lecture. I'm sure that the audience gathered a lot of knowledge and inspiration from your talk. I now request Professor Sudarshan Padmanabhan to facilitate the speaker with a memento. Thank you, sir. I now request our speaker for today, Ambassador Nirupama Rao, to leave a message for the ITM community in the EML yearbook. We express our gratitude to Ambassador Nirupama Rao for giving us this opportunity to have her with us today. Ma'am, it was indeed a pleasure hosting you here. The session is now closed. EML team thanks everyone for their support.